I'm from Sweden, live in Stockholm, work in Uppsala, 70 kilometers north of Stockholm, which is the oldest university in the far north. You may not consider it to be old, but we had to have the inland ice gone before we could build something. So this is from 1477. I will now directly to my topic. And with a short introduction, I think most of you know about this, but we have a subject awake, we anesthetize a patient. What happens? You know that FRC is reduced. You may know that the compliance of the lung is reduced or the elastance is increased, and that the resistance of the airways is also increased. The question is why? First of all, loss of muscle tone. I think that is a major point for all changes that we do see during anesthesia, because it has a number of effects on how the lung looks like and how it functions. So the loss of muscle tone allows a decrease of FRC because there is a balance normally between the outward forces of the rib cage and the muscles in the rib cage and the inward forces of the lung, the elastic forces of the lung. And if the outward forces decrease because of the anesthetic, then the inward forces can act on the lung and reduce the volume further. And this smaller volume can result in a lower compliance, even though the tissue per se may not have changed. If you do take away one lung in a patient for some reason, the compliance will be reduced, but the remaining lung may be unaltered, even a little expanded. But the volume per se is reduced. Increase in the resistance. Well, if the lung volume is reduced, also the airway dimensions are reduced. So the most simple explanation as to why resistance is increased is the decrease in airway dimensions as a consequence of the decrease in lung volume. We do not need, as many have tried to explain it, by different effects of anesthetics on tone and so on, but that is not necessary. There might be additional comfort. Anyway, this causes, or these changes can lead to what I will discuss a lot about, airway closure, atelectasis. These are the two major phenomena that we do see during anesthesia. If you want to see some morphological functional effect, it will go back to this, more than any other aspects. Edema, no. Hypoperfusion, well, that's another cause than anesthesia mostly. So I have reason to go to these two. And let us then have a look at it. This is a CT of a subject awake first, heart catheterization, because we did research in the mid-early 80s. And this patient has a diaphragm, top of the diaphragm, so the cat is just on top of the diaphragm. You see some vessels, otherwise the lungs are aerated, well aerated. And we do know that FRC, as I said, is reduced by some 20%, 0.4, 0.5 liters. When we are awake, sitting up or standing up, you have an FRC, resting lung volume, that may be around 3.5 liters. When you lie supine, FRC goes down by 0.7, 0.8 liters, simply because the diaphragm is pushed cranially by the abdominal organs. And then anesthesia causes a further decrease by 0.4, 0.5 liters. We are now down to close to residual volume. And that might be good to understand that as an anesthetist or nurse, that patients who are anesthetized and ventilated, or perhaps breathing spontaneously, they breathe very near their residual volume. And that is the lowest volume you can reach voluntarily by expiring as much as possible. That is where you are during anesthesia. And I think that is the most important effect of the anesthetic and the consequence of the lung. I repeat it. Now, what happens when we have anesthetized a patient? This is an early CT when we started to do this in the beginning of the 80s. You see in the bottom of both lungs densities. And you see this larger area, that is the diaphragm that has been cushed cranially. So that is what I said earlier. Diaphragm goes up cranially during anesthesia, and the cut level is the same here and there. So this is what we have seen with CT, and then we have to explain this. It might be good to repeat what has happened before. Bendix and Laver, Pontoppidan, they had a classic paper in New England Journal of Medicine from 1963, where they talked about the concept of atelectasis. But they could never show any atelectasis. On the conventional chest X-ray, you don't see densities that you see here. So that was one reason to consider their concept to be less likely, or at least not proven. The other was that they showed a successive change in blood gases and suggested that would be slow absorption atelectasis, whereas we mostly see a rather rapid change on the induction of anesthesia. And I come back to that. And then there's another paper I must mention. That is Damgaard Pedersen and Quist from Denmark, who wrote already in 1980, but in a journal that most anesthetists do not read, perhaps, Pediatric Radiology, about the densities they had in anesthetized children of pediatrics that were a few years old, and even less. And they could see these densities and suggested that might be a very closure phenomena. So there is a background. But then we did a number of studies starting in 1985 and published onwards. But we needed to identify these densities. What are they? We went to animal experiments. And this is a sheep study, the sheep in the front, doctors in the back, the CT. And you can see that in a sheep, we do see small amount of densities. We wanted more because we would like to make histology afterwards. And we wanted more. We tried with pigs, dogs, even rabbits. But we wanted as much as possible. So finally, we went to a horse. So this is a horse that we have brought into the CT scanner. You see that it's not a big one. It's a pony. It was not clear whether we had a permit to bring them in, so we used dark horses in the middle of the night. And you can see the result. This is the same as you saw on the slide. 1:30 in the night. Still there were rumors, and I had to go to the hospital director to explain what was going on in the middle of the night. We had tried to protect it by putting a cap on the head of the nose, or the head, but you know, there's a long nose as well. But you can see here, this horse has about 50-60% of the lung area covered by densities. And it is well known by veterinarians that horse anesthesia is a tricky thing. If they are given 100% oxygen, PaO2 might be 10 kilopascal. So the anesthesia of an expensive thoroughbred horse is a very expensive an adventure. And because when the horse wakes up, having a PA, this amount of densities, not explained yet what it is, and wake up and breathe air again, a number of the horses die in severe hypoxemia. So what is it? In some of these, we took out the lung, and it is just what we already know now, atelectasis. No edema, no vascular congestion, very sharp border between the atelectasis, as we call it now, and the aerated tissue. One can discuss what this means to strain and other more modern expressions than at this time. And we do see, if we dare to translate or say that what we see in man is the same atelectasis, and there are all reasons to do that, then we can say that we see it in during spontaneous breathing and mechanical ventilation. We see it with almost all anesthetics, save one, and that is ketamine. So that is why I was interested in the previous talk, where ketamine EEG was very different from the other ones. I don't know where the presenter is, but it was a nice talk. If there's any connection between the EEG and the functional phenomena in the lung and in the body. Anyway, I go for it. So ketamine is the only difference. These densities last, or atelectasis, they last a couple of days postoperatively. And I think that is also another important aspect. This atelectasis that is caused by the anesthesia remains after the surgery for different periods of time, depending on what kind of surgery that has been done. But since we will come closer and closer to protective ventilation during anesthesia, that is a la mode today, it can be good to know that protective ventilation during anesthesia and all these huge multicenter studies, they focus on anesthesia. And they can say that if you do this and that, we have made the lung better prepared for waking up or postoperatively. But they disregard that what might have been eliminated during the anesthesia may remain or appear for much longer time after surgery. And I will come back to that. But I want to emphasize it because this is a little provocative. Almost all patients develop atelectasis. It's a range from zero to quite a lot. I mean, on average, 3-4% of lung area. Doesn't sound much, but that is 10-15% of lung tissue. And even in an uneventful anesthesia, we can have 25-30% of the lung collapsed. That is normal, but there is a variation. And you don't see them on the X-ray. Probably it's the spine and the transverse processes that create a shadow where these densities are, or atelectasis. So then what causes the atelectasis? When I saw this the first time, I thought it was compression of the lung. That was the because I gave a talk on this the very first time in Milan, and Luciano Gattinone and other people were there listening, and soon when I had left, they brought ARDS patients to the CT scanner and found much more of these densities or atelectasis. And I think this impressive work he has done. And then it was considered to be compression. The heavy lung collapses under its own weight. And then I thought, okay, that happens during anesthesia. But this is not right. It is gas absorption, yes. What is that? Because this can be treated by you. We have something called airway closure. This is an old figure Frank Netter wrote in the SIVA book, Wangle. You know, around the lung, there is a pleural space with normally a negative pressure. And it's a difference between the bottom and the top, around 7 centimeters of water pressure difference. But if you expire deeply, this is to residual volume. You can have a pleural pressure that becomes positive in the lower part of the pleural space or the thorax. If you are sitting up, expiring maximally, it will be here. If you are lying supine, as prepared for anesthesia and during anesthesia, this higher pleural pressure will be in the dorsal part. If you inspire, this is up to vital capacity, you will still have the same pressure difference between this and that point, but now it's much more negative. And that opens up or keeps the whole lung open. There is even no difference in alveolar sizes between different places. But during anesthesia, what can then happen? FRC is reduced during anesthesia. As I said, almost down to residual volume. That must cause airway closure. And we have shown airway closure during anesthesia. So this is a major effect of the fall in FRC. And the fall in the FRC is almost always a consequence, effect of an anesthesia. So let us then look at what can we see on the ventilation and perfusion matching awake and during anesthesia. Because this is a rather, I would say, advanced study. I made the catheterization of the patients in my lab. We brought the patient down to the CT scanner, took CTs awake, anesthetized the patient at the CT scanner, and this is what we got here in this example. You have atelectasis in bottom of both lungs. Now we move the patient to a new place where we had a gamma camera, and then we made a SPECT or a gamma image. I will come to it. And then afterwards, if there was still time, we moved the patient to the operating theater. Of course it was. And now look at this. I think that our host showed this image in the beginning, the distribution of ventilation and blood flow in an awake subject, taken from John West and Permet and other studies. And you can see that in the normal awake situation, you have a slight increase, a certain increase in ventilation, the dotted line, and you have an increase in perfusion down the lung. On the whole, there's a rather good match between ventilation and blood flow, not everywhere, but on the whole. Now, look at what it is during anesthesia, because I think this is still worth to see. First of all, you see that perfusion, the closed circles, increases down the lung, except for the very bottom, similar to what we see in an awake subject. But then what happens with the ventilation? Now this is mechanical ventilation, but I don't think spontaneous will make much of a difference. The open squares shows how ventilation is distributed. And you can see that in the very bottom, there is no ventilation. That corresponds to the atelectasis. But we do have perfusion, that is shunt. That is a major explanation to any impairment of oxygenation during anesthesia. Then we have above this collapsed area, a region where we have less ventilation than perfusion. That causes what we say low VQ. That is another additional factor to impairment of the oxygenation of blood. And this is airway closure. This is atelectasis, this is airway closure. And on top of this, we have a region where we have a major part of ventilation. High VQ. It's to breathe to some extent without any good reason to do. This ventilation exceeds by far the perfusion. If you measure dead space with the CO2 technique as you do traditionally, you will measure this as a dead space, but it is not really dead space. Dead space is normal or even reduced during anesthesia, but this high VQ will have a similar effect on gas exchange. So there are clear-cut changes. So this is the pattern you have in the patient you have in front of you. Now, what can we do about that? During the last 5-6 years, there have come almost like an invasion papers on protective ventilation during anesthesia. These are huge multicenter studies published in the greatest journals, New England Journal of Medicine, The Lancet. I am co-author of a few, feeling more like a hostage than happy. And I know that when we got rejected in the New England Journal because they had already a paper that showed something different, it was submitted to The Lancet and that was accepted. So rather close in time, one showed one thing and the other showed another thing. Both were huge multicenter clinical trials, all these fancy words that you should have in your study to get accepted and published. So let us see on some of these papers. One of the first coming up was the one by Futier, New England Journal of Medicine, where they show that low tidal volume recruitment of the lung, the re-expansion, and PEEP was beneficial, reduced postoperative lung complications. But the title of the paper was only on low tidal volume. And that forced Goldenberg and Brian Kavanaugh to write a critical comment that it was not only tidal volume that they were playing with, it was also PEEP and recruitment. Severignini has a smaller study, but well controlled, showing also that the combination of this might be beneficial. Futier came back a year later, now PEEP was the important thing. You have papers that low tidal volume was not of benefit, nor the Fernando Bustamante paper, no benefit of low tidal volume. I am a co-author, or well, we are 50 authors or something, on this Provillo study, showing that PEEP of 12, whatever 12 shall be have chosen, is no better than SEEP. In fact, the PEEP 12 patients needed more fluid and vasoactive drugs to maintain blood pressure. You can go on, I will not do that, but I can mention in the bottom you have a paper, Ari Serpaneto, where they also put in driving pressure. And driving pressure is something of interest that has been presented by or suggested or shown by Marcello Amato and a lot of co-authors, because it was a pooled material, but I like that study. Anyway, there. Why do we have these studies? Why do they differ in their recommendations? I mean, this is serious, in my opinion. If you are reading a paper in New England Journal or Lancet suggesting that you shall do this and that, and then you, after that, read another paper from the Lancet, then you'll see that you shall do it in an opposite way. So why can it be that? And one reason may be that the three major tools that have been used for creating protective ventilation have been taken over from intensive care, and thus from a different category of patients with severely sick lungs that may be more vulnerable to forces caused by mechanical ventilation. Under certain emotion, I have written together with Lennart Edmark an editorial that is coming out in anesthesiology during the fall. This is taken from that. And let us then go to the three tools. And they are a load-headed volume or a low-driving pressure, assumed to reduce stress and strain of the lung. Two, a recruitment maneuver assumed to reopen any collapsed alveoli. And three, a positive end expiratory pressure PEEP assumed to keep the lung open during ongoing anesthesia and surgery. And you see that I use the word assumed because the tools have not been verified in the studies that have been conducted. They add, say that we use a low-tally volume, we use a recruitment maneuver, we use PEEP, but the consequences intraoperatively have not really been demonstrated in these individual studies. But I agree, some of these studies show a reduction in postoperative lung complications. But I just wonder, will it depend on this or something else? And I come back to that. Because protective ventilation covers a period from induction to emergence from anesthesia. And when there any positive effects remain in the postoperative period is unknown. But let us look at the tools first and come back to what comes after the anesthesia and surgery. Low tidal volume, that has been the most frequently suggested or claimed variable to that can have an impact on postoperative lung complications. And now look at this. If we have an FRC awake, 2.8 liters in the supine position, that is possible. The tidal volume of 500 mL is 7 mL per kilogram body weight, which would then be rather low. And that is 18% of FRC. And why do I emphasize that? Because this is a reflection of the strain on the lung. And strain has been a very popular word. And driving pressure is related to reducing or affecting strain. So this is a normal value, very normal. Even if you go to 700 mL per kilogram body weight, 10 milligram per kilogram body weight, the strain is 25%. This is normal breathing. And when you breathe normally, you have a smaller and larger tidal breath for different respiratory rates over the time. Let us look at anesthesia. FRC is here reduced by 0.4 liters in my example. So the tidal volume will now result in a strain of 21% instead of 18. And if you take a 700 mL breath, that's 10 milligram per kilogram body weight, which is almost a little high for some people to see, that is 29% strain compared to 25 in the awake subject. Not very much of a difference. Okay, you see, there is a difference, yeah, but not much. Look at the ARDS. I call it EELV, end expiratory lung volume, that's FRC, but with a PEEP you call it EELV. And it can be, in the worst case, half a liter. What does a 700 mL tidal volume mean there? 10 milliliter per kilogram body weight. That is 140% strain. That's a quite different number from what we talk about here. And even if you go down to 6 mL per kilogram, I mean, as you suggest to do, the strain is 84%. It's far above this. So what may be important to achieve here may need not be similarly important during anesthesia. I must say that I don't see that the size of the tunnel volume, provided that you are below 12 or something, is of any importance. I know that there can be 50, 60 people here who would not like this and say something else, but I'm here to be a little provocative. Driving pressure, which I like as a new concept, if you want it, will be affected by your setting. Lower driving pressure for a given tidal volume if FRC is increased. We have to remember that. It is not only to lower the tidal volume, that reduces driving pressure, because driving pressure is the pressure required to put in a certain volume. And you measure end inspiration, end expiration during static conditions. And this volume will be in percent of the FRC, and if the FRC is increased or EELV is increased, you will have a lower strain. So driving pressure together with FRC give you information about the strain that you expose the lung to. But again, I don't see that this is of extreme importance, but it's good to know. Now, tool number two, recruitment. It was also being claimed that you shall do a recruitment. And papers show that you do a recruitment soon after induction, perhaps intermittently during anesthesia, and late at the end of the anesthesia. We have done that some time ago, 20 years, where we had the patient awake, no atelectasis, clear lungs. We do anesthesia, I don't see the number. Yeah. You see atelectasis in the bottom. This is after end inspiration, 10, I miss some things. This is zero, this is 10 centimeter of water airway pressure. Down, so there is atelectasis, zero airway pressure. Now we go to 10, nothing happens. We go to 20 centimeter of water airway pressure, which was something I was taught to do during my short period as an anesthetist, to keep the lung open, a kind of recruitment. But 20 centimeter of water airway pressure does do nothing. And this was kept for 15 seconds. But there was no recruitment. We had to go to 40 centimeter of water airway pressure. I'm sorry for the missing numbers. 40 centimeter of water airway pressure. Then we opened up the lung. Some still had slight amount of atelectasis, but 40, we call that a vital capacity, because what we inflated the lung with was the same as a patient could inspire voluntarily awake before the study. So a simple thing is to do a vital capacity maneuver, 40 centimeter water, and 10 seconds are enough. There are studies showing different procedures to do this, and it was Heartland, and what it arrives at is that it doesn't matter whether you do stepwise increases or do a more rapid change as we did. The result will be the same, provided that they reach 40 centimeter of water airway pressure. Some have even reached 50 centimeter, which I think might be a little tricky, I don't know. So recruitment can be useful, but you need to know that you have opened the lung to claim that you did the recruitment. I'm not sure that the big studies do know that. PEEP, finally. It is being claimed that adequate level of PEEP prevents recurrence of atelectasis. That is what we all learn. I have said that to students. You apply a PEEP to prevent collapse. But it may be more. Ventilation with PEEP may even recruit a normal lung in a subject with normal body BMI. And we have done that long ago, and I have not really put it into my own mind. You have a patient here with ZEEP. A lady, rather large amount of atelectasis. This can be 20% of the lung tissue. This is the top of the diaphragm. SEEP, airway pressure 11 centimeter of water during inspiration. Then we apply a PEEP and no recruitment, just a PEEP. Almost all atelectasis is gone. We have some left, but not very much. P peak pressure is 18 centimeter of water. This has been for 5 or 10 minutes, I don't remember now. So there is a time effect that nobody has really discussed. You say that you need to do recruitment to open up the lung. I say that in a healthy lung during anesthesia, it might be enough with PEEP. But it takes some time, 5-10 minutes, to open up the lung. And then the problem I thought at that time, this is the mid-80s, was that when you took away the PEEP, 1 minute after, the atelectasis starts back. There was no lasting effect, which was disappointing, I would say. And I thought, okay, PEEP is of no use. As soon as you discontinue the patient from the ventilator or machinery, atelectasis comes back. That cannot be good. On the other hand, you can say afterwards, you can put the patient on the PEEP again, and you will again open up the lung. No lasting effect if PEEP is discontinued, and possibly no improved oxygenation. That is also true, and that has to do with the effect on circulation and perfusion distribution. And in John Nunn and Hewlett wrote already in 1974, 10 or more years before we have the CT and atelectasis, no indiscriminate use of PEEP in routine anesthesia. And the reason was that they did not see any improvement in oxygenation. So why should one then use PEEP? Now I think one shall focus a little differently on this. Oxygenation may not be the most important thing. And PEEP may be easier to use and safer to open the lung and keep it open than intermittent recruitment maneuvers. Somewhat of what I'm saying here is my opinion, and I cannot say that we have done hundreds of patients to show that this is safer and better than recruitment maneuvers. On the other hand, I am convinced that if we introduce recruitment to 40 or 50 centimeter of water airway pressure, we will sooner or later have a complication by that. And why do something that may not be necessary? This is the second time I give this talk or about this, because this is an editorial from which I have taken the text. So then the question is, how much PEEP? And that will depend on the BMI, of course. In a normal BMI, I would say PEEP 6 to 8 centimeter water might suffice. Whereas in obese subjects, high PEEP is most likely required, 10 or more. And the atelectasis is caused by our closer distal airways that promotes absorption atelectasis by continuous uptake of oxygen from the alveoli. So when I talked about resorption atelectasis, it is airway closer, and behind the closed airway, the gas and then mainly oxygen will be absorbed into the bloodstream. And then the replacement by CO2 is not much value, because CO2 will dissolve into the tissue per se. So closing pressure is around 7 or 8 perhaps during anesthesia. And we have done studies on what is the closing pressure long ago. It's 1980 or something. So that is a number we have seen in our studies. Of course, there's a variation around it. But to take the mean, this suggests that to keep airways open, a PEEP of 7 centimeter water is appropriate. Again, that's a rule of thumb, nothing else. Low PEEP or lower PEEP will not be enough to keep the airways open all over the lung, and may therefore not be expected to recruit or even keep all lung open. A higher PEEP may compromise hemodynamics, and in one study a PEEP of 12 was applied. I was a co-author, I'm not happy. And this required increased fluid administration and use of vasoactive drugs. It was the Provigio study. But I must say that this cannot result in a conclusion that PEEP is of no use. Only that unnecessarily high PEEP may be. I remember in the 60s when I was the anesthetist and did the simpler things, I anesthetized patients who were to undergo coronary angiography. Why did we do that? Because the radiologist wanted the heart to more or less stop. So anesthetizing the patient and applying an airway pressure of 40 centimeter of water, 40 centimeter, stopped the heart after some time. And the radiologist was happy, getting perfect images, at least technically. And I was the youngest, most anxious doctor, was very concerned, how can I get the heart starting again? But the effect of high pressure in the lung is well known, of course. Now we have heard about the range of opinions around these three tools. And in this editorial now that is coming out December, obviously, we conclude, don't ask me what this is, I have not put it in, without knowing how successful the protective ventilation is during anesthesia. And these studies do not do that. And more worse, and if any positive effects remain in the postoperative period, reduction in postoperative pulmonary complications can hardly be attributed to protective ventilation. This has not come out, but I foresee rather strong comments around this by people I know. And it's more than this now. What does protective ventilation, as it has been presented in all these huge studies, thousands of patients, New England Journal, Lancet, Anesthesiology, JAMA, they do not take up inspiratory gas flow pattern, and I think that doesn't matter. I would not bother about whether they have a rapid increase in flow or positive ramp or negative ramp or square way. I don't think that matters unless you have a severe lung sick patient, there you can play with it. But the other things, inspired oxygen concentration, that is not at all discussed in all these big studies. I'm silent for a second. And then what happens after emergence from anesthesia? These are important things. And leave that. We did a study some time ago again, as usual, 1995. Hans-Willy Roten is from Bern in Switzerland. He was a couple of years in my department. We dared to pre-oxygenate a patient with only 30% oxygen. So anesthesia was induced not with 100% oxygen, hear that, not 100% oxygen, but with 30% oxygen. We were not brave enough to go to air, but 30% was a kind of compromise for our mental health. And you can see the awake patient, a few vessels, no atelectasis. Now, post-induction, no atelectasis. We were used to see quite a bit, varying degrees. Even half an hour later, we have no atelectasis. There's a tiny 1 per mil atelectasis. So it was a big effect. The atelectasis during anesthesia that we regularly see and accept as a finding is caused by the induction, not by the anesthesia, but by the short-acting inducing agent, because it lowers FRC. And that together with 100% oxygen is a perfect combination to cause atelectasis. And that takes only 4 or 5 minutes, shorter than calculations may suggest, simply because when the lung volume, in particular in the bottom dorsal part, is reduced, the collapse goes faster. No, you can pre-oxygenate with other concentrations. Here we have tried with 100%, 80, 60, and we had the 30 from the previous study. And this was done by Lennart Edmark. You see 12 patients whose induction was during pre-oxygenation with 100% oxygen. This is expired oxygen, that's why we are not at 100, but a little lower. All patients develop atelectasis, but with a varying extent. Another 12 got 80%, much less atelectasis. And another 12 got 60%, almost no atelectasis. And this is the previous study with 30% oxygen.
There's a very strong correlation to the oxygen concentration during pre-oxygenation. Before you can consider to be the regular anesthesia. There is a price. If you look at the time it takes to develop hypoxemia or 90% saturation with the pulse oximeter during apnea, it takes with 100% oxygen 425 seconds. If you go down to 80%, you lose 100 seconds, and with 60, another loss of 100 seconds. And for sure, if you give air during, if you don't do any pre-oxygenation, you will be down to a minute. So I understand that we have to give something. The question is, do we need to give 100%? Then you say we lose 100 seconds. Yes, I agree. And I even got the nasty question of what would you like to receive if you are the patient? And then I look to the right and keep silent. I understand this. Can we do it differently? We come back to that. This oxygen that is often used, or I would say abused, by the anesthetist. I hope you hear what I say. And they have a secret exit. This is when you do a recruitment maneuver, this vital capacity maneuver that I talked about earlier. We have awake, we have anesthesia, this amount of atelectasis. We do the recruitment maneuver, and at time zero we have basically no atelectasis. During ventilation with 40% oxygen, we have this amount of atelectasis coming back slowly. This is 40 minutes after the recruitment maneuver. We have only 20% of the initial atelectasis. So here we have a kind of lasting effect. Provided that we give moderate concentration of oxygen. What happens if we give 100% oxygen? We have the previous figure in the behind, and then have another group who got 100% oxygen after the recruitment maneuver. Within 5 or 10 minutes, we had almost all that atelectasis back, and then there was slight further increase. So if we ventilate with 100% oxygen, any recruitment maneuver will be very short-lived. We have a very critical dependence on the inspired oxygen concentration. And since I'm not the youngest one here, I think the oldest perhaps, I am almost surprised that oxygen has not been discussed more in the anesthesia society. Now, if you need to give oxygen, we can do it perhaps under a little different conditions. This is a group of patients received on zero end-expiratory pressure, ventilated with 100% oxygen. They are awake, they are anesthetized, get this amount of atelectasis, they are recruited by 40 centimeter water, the vital capacity maneuver. And then you can see how fast the atelectasis is coming back. Within 4 or 5 minutes, as you have atelectasis back. Now, if you have another group of patients that put people 10 after or at the end of the recruitment, you see they get this amount of atelectasis, they are recruited, and now they are ventilated with 100% oxygen at the people 10, and we have almost no atelectasis, at least much less. So if you, for some reason, consider it necessary to give high oxygen concentration, you can recruit and apply a certain amount of PEEP. Why is it this? Why do we develop atelectasis and so strongly correlated to the inspired oxygen concentration? This is a lung pre-oxygenation. We can have 30 to 100% oxygen. We take a small piece of the lung out. You see here the lung, the airways are open, alveoli are open. We induce anesthesia with some short-acting drug. FRC is reduced. And now we develop a closer because of the decrease in lung volume. So that means that this part of the lung is now closed to the atmosphere. Closer, and we don't correspond with the atmosphere. Now, if we give 70 to 20% nitrogen, then the alveoli will not collapse, not that fast at least, because nitrogen acts as a scaffold. It prevents the alveoli to collapse. But if you don't have any nitrogen, pure oxygen, the alveolus will collapse within 4 or 5 minutes. You see the number of examples for it. So oxygen is of importance. So how to prevent atherectasis assisting anesthesia? We have shown or talked about restoring FRC with PEEP. We can avoid high oxygen or give high oxygen during PEEP. Then can we prevent the fall in FRC? Because if the FRC is maintained at the awake level, we will not have airway closure or less of airway closure than if FRC is reduced. And what about emergence? So let us begin with the induction of anesthesia. There is a study from Lausanne showing, comparing two groups of patients. One is whose anesthesia is induced and ventilated without the normal way, pre-oxygenation 100%, and I would say that this is perhaps more, I wouldn't call that atelectasis, but for sure there is an increase in the densities reflecting atelectasis. Then another group was breathing on the face mask CPAP, 6 centimeter water airway pressure. Anesthesia was induced, and there was an intubation of the airway, and then immediately, as soon as possible, application of PEEP-06. There is a short period when there is no pressure applied to the lung, when you intubate the airway. But obviously it takes a little time to develop anything, and you can see that in this case there was no more atelectasis or no atelectasis. So by preventing the fall in FRC during inductive anesthesia, you can give 100% oxygen and do not develop atelectasis. This also applies to morbidly obese patients, so this is not limited to an ideal material. Then you can discuss how easy is it to apply this CPAP PEEP, but that is a technical aspect that I leave to the anesthetist since I'm no longer that. Finally, efforts to keep the lung open should also focus on the emergence from anesthesia. And using 100% oxygen during emergence and extubation is common and often combined with airway suctioning. I can tell you that I wrote sometimes or perhaps, but the editor of the anesthesiology wanted to have often. So you often combine it with airway suctioning. However, this combination might be the ultimate way of producing atelectasis. I have examples from pig experiments. These are pigs with healthy lungs. We have aspired down to minus 100 centimeter water, with a strong aspiration from the lung. And you can see how much atelectasis we can produce. And I don't know how low the pressure is during airway suctioning, but if you have an occluded airway, then behind that occlusion, I think you can come down considerably in the airway pressure to negative values. So this is what you might deliver to the postoperative ward. Now this is the bottom line for me. You spend a lot of efforts, read papers, protect the ventilation during anesthesia, do it perfectly correct, and then you suction the airway, post-oxygenate, and deliver this kind of patient. And after anesthesia, the atelectasis remains for some time. This is upper abdominal surgery, which may be the cause of the most long-lasting atelectasis. This is pre-anesthesia, nothing. Anesthesia, we have this amount of atelectasis. 2 hours after surgery, we have even more atelectasis. And then the first day, second day, fourth day, see how it slowly resolves. So now, when you say that we protect the patient from atelectasis during 1 hour or 2 hours of anesthesia, what does that mean if you have 3-4 days of atelectasis afterwards? And in fact, you contribute to the production of atelectasis at the end of the surgery, of the anesthesia. I think it's time to consider how correct that is. Can we do something when patients are waking up? This is a study again by Lennart Edmark up in Uppsala, Västerås. And you can see we let patients wake up with or without CPAP, PEEP. So one group was on mechanical ventilation. They were not post-oxygenated, if I remember correctly, no airway suctioning. But they had this amount of atelectasis, half an hour, 20 minutes to 30 minutes after the anesthesia, after the waking up. And this was non-abdominal, non-thoracic surgery. So it was, I think it was neck surgery. So this is what you can see even without having touched the lung or the abdomen. If you apply PEEP 6 at the end of the anesthesia and try to maintain it with the CPAP during the emergence and afterwards, you reduce atelectasis considerably. It is not gone. You might need more pressure, and above all, you need to be able to have a patient who tolerates a CPAP face mask during the wake up. That is difficult. Yes. So I cannot say that you have the tool here, but what I can say is that if you can restore FRC or prevent falling FRC during emergence, then the patient will be much better off, whatever the technique is that you want to use. So taken together, this is a summary in this editorial also. Tidal volume seems not to be a big issue, unless you have been thinking of tidal volumes of 20 or about 15 mil. Recruitment maneuver may not be necessary, provided that the graded PEEP is applied that keeps airways open. It's more opinion from my side than really proof. Inspired oxygen concentration should be kept as low as possible. I think 30-40% in an open lung is unnecessarily high, but I dare not say lower than that. But a healthy lung in the wakes up patient, he or she is breathing PaO2 is 10, 11, 12 kilopascal or 75, 90 millimeter of mercury. And then you maintain FRC or keep the lung open during anesthesia. Why should it be less oxygenation, by less PaO2? I don't see any reason, provided that the lung is open. And then finally, the patient should be delivered to the postoperative ward with an open lung, and there the lung should be kept open. And I think this last sentence is the most important one. It would be smart, in my opinion, that the anesthetist has a responsibility for the patient also for some time after surgery. How that is solved locally, I don't know. So this was what I wanted to show and discuss, and I have been a little provocative, so now I relax, going back to my sailboat, and leave you. Thanks a lot.